Welcome to First Air Assault's training video, Fundamental Skills Training, Module 1. New members are given the choice of watching this guide or reading the manual itself before attending Module 1 training. The use of pre-work avoids new members having trainers read from manuals during module training. Instead, in-game time is better used for hands-on training. Module 1 covers who we are, how things are done in First Air Assault, and more importantly, why they're done this way. Starting with who we are, two real-life military concepts come together to create the fictitious world First Air Assault operates in. NATO Response Force and the military doctrine of air assault. Let's look closer at both of these. Created in 2003, member nations contribute military forces to the NATO Response Force, or NRF.
The main role of the NATO Response Force is to ensure that we send a strong message to potential aggressors. Collective defense, of course, one of the core mandates of a NATO alliance. It's made up of 40,000 personnel from land, sea, and maritime and special forces elements.
But what if NATO decided to create its very own military force? It's not unthinkable. Many European countries have discussed just this idea.
The French president, Emmanuel Macron, has reiterated his belief that Europe needs its own army.
If NATO did create its own military force, the first unit commissioned would likely be a response force. The military doctrine of air assault would be a perfect choice. And to understand why, a review of what air assault is. Helicopters are a common sight among the militaries around the world, and it begs the question, does a helicopter equal air assault? The military doctrine of air assault is defined as the movement of ground-based military forces by vertical takeoff and landing aircraft, such as the helicopter. These are used to seize and hold key terrain which is not being fully secured, and to directly engage enemy forces behind enemy lines. With many modern militaries using rotary wing aircraft to transport personnel and supplies, it's easy to be confused about what deserves the air assault label. The U.S. Army's training manual notes, an air assault is not synonymous with an air movement. They are separate and distinct missions. Air assaults are not merely movements of soldiers, weapons, and equipment by Army aviation units and should not be considered as such. The training manual goes on to clearly outline what air assault is. An air assault operation is an operation in which assault forces, using the mobility of rotary wing assets and the total integration of available firepower, maneuver under the control of commanders to engage enemy forces or to seize and hold key terrain. They allow friendly forces to strike over extended distances and terrain barriers to attack the enemy when and where he is most vulnerable. Air assault isn't necessarily a new concept. On November 5, 1956, the Royal Marines 45 Commando performed the world's first air assault during an amphibious landing as part of Operation Musketeer.
Arriving in the Egyptian capital from Alexandria, where he proclaimed his seizure of the Suez Canal Company, President Nasser finds Cairo's population in a veritable nationalistic frenzy. An acclaiming multitude which escorts him like a hero to the presidential palace, where he delivers another fiery speech in answer to opposition to his provocative action.
Taking place in Suez, Egypt, British forces inserted 650 Marines and 23 tons of equipment. However, air assault gained military popularity and began its modern evolution during the Vietnam War. This was the moment when America changed the dynamic of warfare, making it more about statistics than front lines.
Yeah.
Called Air Mobility, search and destroy missions took American forces far beyond secure bases and traditional support. One of the more famous air assault missions took place on November 14, 1965. Lieutenant Colonel Harold G. Moore led his troops in the first large unit engagement of the Vietnam War, known today as the Battle of La Drang Valley. Considered to be the first large-scale helicopter air assault, the battle is recounted in the book We Were Soldiers Once and Young, and later in 2002 when the book was adapted to a movie starring none other than Mel Gibson. Since these early historical footsteps, air assault has become a specialized military doctrine practiced by the following. The 16th Air Assault Brigade of the British Army, who is the UK's main air assault body. Britain's 3 Commando Brigade Royal Marines are also highly experienced in air assault, both for boarding ships and in land attacks. The United States Army tasks its 101st Airborne Division for air assault. And all U.S. Marine Corps divisions routinely train for and perform air assault operations. With the ability to quickly project military power with self-sufficiency, air assault is the perfect choice for NATO's first fully commissioned force. The air assault unit is assigned the indicator of first, as it's the first military unit under the direct command of NATO. Because the unit is the first force to serve solely under the NATO flag, first air assault is designed to be self-sufficient in mobility, logistics, and support. This allows for the unit to operate anywhere NATO feel they are needed without relying on resources or support from any other militaries or governments. The unit can be deployed anywhere in the world within 12 hours to 5 days, depending on the complexity of the mission and the equipment required. First Air Assault is tasked with supplementing the existing militaries of NATO member nations, whether through difficult or complex missions beyond their own forces' capabilities, or as a quick military response to security issues or national threats. Utilizing military tactics, extensive training, and cutting-edge technology, First Air Assault can be inserted deep into hostile territory and tasked with the following. Seize. Destroy. Capture, recover, damage, and reconnaissance. Now we've covered what NATO response and air assault are, let's review how they come together in Arma 3 to create the online gaming group First Air Assault. The group operates in two worlds, administrative and in-game or operational. Turning to the administrative side of the group, first and foremost, First Air Assault does not run on rank, nor is anyone called sir. Every member and all ideas are treated equally and with respect. This courtesy of respect is given to anyone, members or otherwise. While other online gaming groups use a mission statement or code of conduct to set standards or rules, First Air Assault uses 3 words to define what the group is and, more importantly, what it strives to be. Honor, respect, and effort. Members should apply these 3 standards to every action, regardless of their time with the group or in what capacity they fill. These standards are at the core of some simple guidelines. Members shall not judge anyone based on their religious beliefs, legally accepted lifestyle, race or gender, or make them feel uncomfortable about their personal choice in any of these matters. Members are expected to give maximum effort at all times. Members shall refrain from excessive profanity, and we'll have more about this later. Sensitive topics such as politics are not discussed in any way within the group. The above standards and guidelines not only maintain who we are while together as a group, but how members represent themselves while away from the unit. Their behavior represents first-air assault outside our bubble, and members who fail to maintain the group's high standard of integrity and understanding may be asked to leave. Following the definition of honor, i.e. honesty and fairness, first-air assault has detailed expectations of attendance, behavior, and all matters related to being a member of an online gaming group within the training manual and indeed within this video. At first glance, this may seem like overkill, but they were pulled together from years of experience of managing other Arma groups. These different resources give a clear understanding of what's expected from the group and what the group expects from its members. It must be stressed, regardless of a person's role within the group, the same rules apply to everyone. Role assignments, mod changes, and other group decisions are made by executive command, which carries the abbreviation of EC. Led by the company commander, the group's founder, executive command relies on the executive staff, which is made up of squad leaders and other key members of the group. Decisions are made using the group's focus and values as a compass and guide. All opinions are heard on every matter, and while a vote is taken, the company commander has the final decision. Obviously, this is only an overview of the administrative world of First Air Assault. Members should make the effort to fully understand what's expected of them in this administrative world. The group sets certain in-game standards to create an immersive world for the unit and deliver the style and quality of gameplay the group was created for. Some of the following standards are relaxed for casual gameplay on the First Air Assault server. Here are some expectations when taking part in official in-game missions and training. The following standards are applied for players' view in-game to create a realistic gaming environment. A first-person view is forced for any member on foot. An exception to this is when training. The third-person view acts as a training aid. First or third person is available when operating both ground and air vehicles. Name tags or speech indicators are not used. Crosshairs are not used. And map view restrictions hide blue four and enemy icons. The following standards are applied to any in-game communications, whether spoken or typed. No excessive profanity. We understand stuff will slip out occasionally. However, if members can't play without using swear words, First Air Assault probably isn't the group for them. Just a few reasons why. Many members have children who can hear what's being said, and some members simply don't want to hear it. This applies to any time spent on First Air Assault servers, TeamSpeak, or forums. No spamming. Whether training or in mission, if no immediate response is received, several things could be happening. The person being contacted is dealing with something else at the moment. They are getting clarification or direction for the request. While the respawning of players and equipment will be mission dependent, the following are First Air Assault's guidelines. The number of First Air Assault vehicles respawned cannot exceed what's maintained in the unit's inventory, and we'll have more about that later. The reinsertion of members will be mission dependent and or when landing zones are secured. The guidelines for attendance of official events are as follows. Members must be present for the entire event. They cannot arrive late or leave early. If unable to attend for an entire event, members shouldn't attend at all. The only exception is attending only the training portion if it's available. When going away from the keyboard, AFK, members must notify the chain of command. Operational structure of First Air Assault, or how the group is managed in-game, is very important to understand as it dictates how things are run during our operations. These only apply to official training and missions, but as always, respect for other members is the minimum requirement for all gameplay on the First Air Assault server. Both First Air Assault's personnel and equipment are carefully chosen, tested, and pushed to their limits, and must consistently overperform for the ongoing success of the unit. Using the military tactic of force multiplication, First Air Assault's structure, training, and equipment allow the unit to battle and defeat numerically superior forces. Used throughout the fundamental skills training and during weekly unit training, the term of force multiplication or force multiplier applies to procedures, tools, equipment, and teamwork. Combined, these allow the group to complete tasks otherwise beyond a unit of First Air Assault size. Force multiplication, in military usage, refers to an attribute or a combination of attributes that multiplies the effectiveness of an item or group, giving the given number of personnel or weapons and hardware the ability to accomplish greater things than without it. The expected size increase required to have the same effectiveness without the advantage is the multiplication factor. For example, if a certain technology like GPS enables a force to accomplish the same results of a force 5 times as large without the GPS, then the multiplier is 5. Such estimates are used by militaries around the world to justify an investment cost for force multipliers. Some of the areas First Air Assault leverages to enjoy different levels of force multiplication are as follows. Ground forces forego front lines for movement, only making enemy contact out of necessity. Air forces bring incredible mobile power when and where required. Personnel are cross-trained to allow them to step into nearly any role when required, and everyone is equally trained to a high standard on both standard as well as advanced skill sets. Formations and traveling are completed to allow for quick, stealthy, and effective movement. Personnel are organized and applied for maximum effect in the area of operations. Specifically designed for the air assault doctrine, they apply overwhelming force at precise tactical points. Next, a look at the operational structure and roles. The unit is led in mission by Zero Alpha. This isn't a permanent assignment, instead, rotated through squad leaders and qualified members who would like to lead the group on a mission. When fully staffed, Zero Alpha has 5 squads to manage. The roles of the different squads are defined by their structure and result in 2 specialty teams and 2 conventional-sized squads. Alpha Squad is designed to be the team that escorts and protects Zero Alpha throughout the mission. Alpha is able to provide mission support with its mortar team, adept to using drone technology, and coordinate with air crew to apply close air support where needed. Considered the hammer of First Air Assault, both Bravo and Charlie are full 13-man squads which bring every aspect of infantry warfare to the battlefield. Made up of 2 6-man fire teams, each are balanced with the combat roles that allow for overwhelming force when used together, as well as the ability to operate effectively apart. Let's look at how Bravo and Charlie squads are structured. Delta Squad is usually the first in and last out of any mission. Delta's specialty is reconnaissance. From ensuring landing zones and insertion points are clear, to acting as overwatch and collecting last-minute intelligence, the small squad specializes in moving quickly through enemy-held territory. If Bravo and Charlie are the hammer, Delta is First Air Assault scalpel. The squad is assigned when a small team is required for technical infiltration or lightning raids. Delta can also be used as a quick response force for the unit. Last but not least, Zulu. First Air Assault's dedicated pilots are trained across the fleet of aircraft used by the group. Zulu pilots can find themselves flying the latest attack drone, heavy VTOL transport, or attack helicopter in support of the unit. The number of pilot positions are scaled to suit the number of active squads. It should be noted that even in combat operations, rank isn't used in communications or as an indication of authority. However, the chain of command will be respected. Failure to do so may result in the member being ejected from the server, as well as face possible further action. Regardless of where a member finds themselves in the chain of command, everyone should have the following priorities at all times. Mission, team, and self. Finally, understanding every set of eyes in an operation collects real-time intelligence. Feedback can be sent up through the chain of command, but it must be done in an appropriate and respectful manner. The operational chain of command can be seen in this organizational chart. The maker of the mission is referred to as headquarters. They determine operational parameters, objectives, and the mission's success. They're available for consultation during mission, even though they assume a combat role in-game. As mentioned earlier, the mission is led by Zero Alpha. This duty is rotated among serving squad leaders and qualified members who request the role. They create and submit an operational plan to headquarters based on the mission's parameters, and they can confer with headquarters during the mission with questions or any needed clarification. Squad leaders of Bravo, Charlie, Delta, and Zulu, they understand and complete their assigned tasks with minimal guidance. They're responsible for managing squad members in and out of operations. They follow the direction of mission lead and obey any decisions accordingly. Squad members complete any order or directive given to the best of their ability. Who assumes the duties of an incapacitated chain of command leader is established ahead of the mission. These include which squad lead steps in for Zero Alpha, which team lead steps in for the different squad leads, and which squad member steps in for a fallen team leader. This part of the video covers how combat roles are assigned. A more detailed review of the role's duties as well as qualities best suited for the different positions can be found at the end of the training manual. As with any ongoing responsibility, the more practice, the better the player becomes. This theory is applied to combat roles in First Air Assault, with members permanently assigned a role until they request a change. Simply put, Member A accepts the role of Automatic Rifleman in Bravo's Squad Fire Team 1, which would be callsigned Bravo 1-4, and fills it every week until requesting and assigned another slot. An exception to this are Members in Training, or MITs. If you're watching this video in order to complete your fundamental skills training, you're considered an MIT. MITs are assigned to empty slots based on mission need and the opportunity to team them up with a more experienced member in mission. With First Air Assault's rule of consistent combat roles, it's recommended MITs test out the roles they're interested in during the fundamental skills training period. To do this, MITs should let someone in the chain of command know when roles are being discussed or assigned before a mission. A common question to the practice of consistency in combat roles tends to be, how often can I change? As often as a member likes is the blanket answer. A member is required to stay in a position for at least 45 days, and to be fair, if they continuously change positions, executive command may have a discussion with the member. Squads will only be activated when the membership supports a full roster for each squad. With this in mind, the squads will be activated with the permanent assignments in the following order: Bravo, Charlie, and Alpha. Zulu conducts ongoing assessments to not only staff the current number of slotted positions, but also maintain an informal reserve to ensure a pool of pilots is always available. Only members in this pool are allowed to fly during official missions and training. Consideration for Delta will be given when Bravo is deemed a seasoned squad and membership justifies the activation of Charlie. As mentioned before, both Delta and Zulu require additional weekly training to retain a position. As we'll see later, 1st Air Assault enjoys custom uniforms featuring hard-coded loadouts. The role-specific hard-coded loadouts are maintained using feedback from leadership as well as members who operate in each specialty. Loadouts are further refined by mission makers with Zero Alpha's guidance to ensure they meet specific operational needs. This system offers the following advantages. Loadouts remain role-specific. Missions aren't delayed while players sort through supply boxes. From Zero Alpha to team leaders, everyone is assured the required inventory items are taken on the mission. Players can't accidentally weigh themselves down to the detriment of the mission. And members spend more time playing and less time waiting. Bearing in mind all the attention and time spent on loadouts, members will respect and adhere to the following requirements. Members should only be standing over a supply box if directed by the chain of command. Even the smallest changes to a loadout requires permission from the chain of command. Members cannot make uniform, headgear, or rifle accessory changes without prior permission. These are all mission-dependent and based on factors such as rules of engagement. Aside from ensuring all required items are taken on missions, wasting time at supply boxes is highly disrespectful to other members' time. If a member feels they need a piece of equipment to meet their mission obligations, just ask. If not directed to the supply boxes by chain of command, someone is misunderstanding a member's role in the mission. It's possible another member is already carrying the required equipment. As with uniforms, most supply and airdrop containers are customized for the group. Contents that aren't hard-coded are usually tailored by the mission maker. If a member can't find a particular item, either the item isn't used by First Air Assault, or they're looking in the wrong place. This video and the fundamental skills training demonstrate the effort that goes into ensuring every member knows how to use all the equipment issued by First Air Assault. To maintain this level of competency, only the equipment members are trained on is used. Another reason for limiting available equipment, every mod is tested for compatibility and in-game performance. Maybe the missing item was tested and didn't play well with other mods in First Air Assault. If the group doesn't use a piece of equipment or mod a member feels would be beneficial, reach out to someone in the chain of command or bring up the suggestion during mission debriefing. Finally, as with everything in First Air Assault, members should ask. A piece of equipment could be stored in a different supply box or was accidentally omitted from the mission. Mission makers are human and can make mistakes. For this reason, and Arma having a habit of being Arma, certain members have Zeus privileges that can rectify any mistakes during the mission. First Air Assault enjoys unique uniforms, customized vehicles, and even enemy troops not found anywhere else in the Arma universe. Expected to conduct operations in different temperate zones with little notice, First Air Assault uses 5 types of camouflage. Retextured Cry-Precision G3-style uniforms are designed to work in a range of theaters. Arid, jungle, snow, woodland, and urban areas. In an effort to go beyond one static camouflage and avoid a cloned effect associated with gaming, each uniform group has been retextured in 3 different patterns. Uniforms are further individualized by combining long and rolled sleeved options. Together, this creates a total of 6 variations in each camouflage type. To create an even more distinctive look for the group, there are 3 further versions within each camouflage pattern. Alpha, Bravo, and Charlie wear matching camouflage shirt and pants, while Delta and Zulu wear solid colored shirts with camouflage pants. Zulu squad members always wear black shirts, and Delta, 1 of 2 colors, depending on the camouflage. Patches on the uniform include the NRF flag, as well as the following designations: Air Assault Tab, Aviation tab, and Recon tab. Here are the five types of camouflage patterns used by First Air Assault. Developing realistic storylines, equipment budgets, as well as the logistics of maintaining and transporting said items to areas of operations have all played a large part in determining what the group wears and uses. Rather than manage multiple versions of matching helmets and tactical vests, solid colors or equipment covers are used. This results in less inventory to maintain and streamlines logistics. As with any equipment, the choice of headgear is limited during any official in-game group time. Currently, four types of headgear are available: helmet, beret, boonies, and patrol cap. Boonies and patrol caps are available in matching camouflage. Headgear is a mission-dependent item. However, the golden rule will always be members should either be wearing a helmet or carrying one. First Air Assault uses the Ops Core Future Assault Shell Technology Helmet, a high-cut combat helmet that provides the highest level of ballistic protection at the lightest weight. The base helmet is black and suited for the group's urban camouflage. Covers matching the respective uniforms allow the base helmet to be used across all the camouflage styles utilized by First Air Assault. Continuing the effort to give each position a unique look, helmet attachments vary by role. Additionally, stenciled information on the rear of the helmet designates squads or roles. Players can choose their facewear and armor. However, First Air Assault represents NATO when deployed, and in an effort to avoid any possible misperceptions on the battlefield or from the media, items hiding the face aren't allowed. To prevent confusion, official supply boxes only contain acceptable items. Tortilla and assault backpacks feature the same stenciled information found on helmets. Customized in khaki or olive green, three types of backpacks are used by First Air Assault. Tortilla, large enough to store a helmet and used when ground forces need enough supplies to weather heavy or prolonged enemy contact. Assault pack, smaller for fast-moving missions which require troop maneuverability and where troops are supported by a supply chain. A helmet can't be stored in these. And specialty backpacks. Containing mortars, plates, and drones, they can't carry any additional items. Weapon systems have been retextured in khaki and olive green. In the fictional world of First Air Assault, the unit was created on a budget, which is most apparent in the group's fleet of aircraft. The number of vehicles operated by First Air Assault is limited and includes older aircraft. Fortunately, the group enjoys attention from several aerospace companies who use First Air Assault as a testbed for some cutting-edge technologies. The following summaries include a lot of information. At minimum, MITs are required to know the basics. What aircraft are used in which role, and the number maintained in First Air Assault's fleet. Here are the vehicles First Air Assault currently uses. As with real-world militaries, vehicle fleet size is based on need, budget, and logistics. In a further effort to bring realism to first air assault gameplay, vehicle inventory is limited to those maintained by the unit, or what's on hand for an operation or deployment. While mission makers can include additional resources in a mission, such as availability of allied aircraft, they can't increase the size of the fleet of vehicles maintained by first air assault. For example, with all the unit's resources fully deployed, first air assault will only ever have 2 Black Hawk helicopters for use. If both are destroyed, the unit must look to other aircraft maintained in the fleet to complete the operation. Don't worry, an expensive requisition order will bring the fleet back to capacity in due time. The purpose of this limitation is to present the group with the same tactical challenges faced by real-world militaries when conducting an operation. From working with a limited fleet of assets to managing risk on the battlefield, First Air Assault must approach every official operation seriously. Here's a recap of the vehicle management in First Air Assault. The number of deployable vehicles is limited to that maintained in First Air Assault's inventory. Damaged vehicles can be repaired during operations by First Air Assault personnel, or, if considered salvageable, retrieved for repair between missions during a deployment. Once a type of vehicle is destroyed, the unit must look to other available alternatives to complete the operation. Availability of allied vehicles must be predefined by headquarters and can't miraculously be shipped in mid-mission. Zero Alpha cannot Zeus their way out of a vehicle issue. They can't place a new Black Hawk on the map if they've all been destroyed. An ally can't donate a similar type of aircraft to First Air Assault during a mission. And vehicles can't be repaired by Zeus powers. What this means for members in game? Well, vehicles are not respawned. The assets available for use are those found on the map at the start of a mission. Members should give serious consideration to their actions when using vehicles in game. Reckless use of a vehicle will impact the effectiveness of the group and possible success of a mission. There will be occasions where circumstances limit vehicles being in-game when a mission starts. A great example of this is the LHD used to deploy First Air Assault personnel and equipment around the world. It's assumed the entire fleet of vehicles is stored on and transported by the LHD, whether in place when the mission starts or not. Ultimately, the goal of the group is to provide an enjoyable Arma experience. Executive Command will make the needed decisions to ensure all members enjoy themselves. One of the first things a new member will do with the group in-game is the First Air Assault Assessment course conducted in Fundamental Skills Training Module 1. The First Air Assault Assessment course is unique to the unit, designed specifically to cover the different player controls used in Arma 3. First, a review of what the assessment course is and isn't. The assessment course is meant to be tackled as a team. MITs move together, closely following the directions of trainers and instructions placed along the course. It's also a method of assessing a new member's comfort level with basic keys, movement, and in-game actions. The assessment course is also an active weapons area. Directions from trainers must be followed at all times, and weapon safety will be covered in more detail later. And finally, the assessment course is an opportunity for trainers and MITs to fill knowledge gaps. The assessment course is not a competition between MITs, nor is it a race. The assessment course isn't an evaluation of how well an MIT plays Arma. And finally, it's certainly not a pass or fail course. The unit maintains high standards of weapons handling with the following standard operating procedures implemented to ensure weapon safety in-game. Unless in a designated team versus team situation, there shall never be friendly fire during an official practice or mission. Other online groups may end practices or operations with friendly fire, but this is not acceptable in First Air Assault. Unless ordered otherwise, weapons shall always be lowered and its safety switched to safe. Simply put, never point a weapon at a friendly. When entering a map, Members should switch their weapon safety to safe. Weapons should only be taken off safe when ordered to, or if the member perceives imminent danger to themselves or other members. Fire control shall be maintained at all times. Scoreboards are not used as a measure of mission success. Instead, whether a shot is taken or not should be weighed against who does the shot benefit. Orders regarding rate of fire or fire discipline should be followed without question, and members should never move in front of a raised weapon. Squad radar. Designed to help with situational awareness, the squad radar appears on the screen as three circles within each other. The radar is meant to provide situational awareness through real-time information of the location of nearby squad members and what their current orientation is. What you need to know about squad radar. Well, it has three circles. The smallest indicates a range of 15 meters. The next is 30 meters, and the largest is 45 meters. Members see squad members relative to them, no other players or units. The member is always at the middle of squad radar. We're coming up to the end of the Fundamental Skills Training Module 1 video. However, there are two more videos MITs need to watch before attending Module 1 training. These are ACE, a walkthrough of the popular realism mod. Radio and communication standards, a review of how the group communicates on and off the radio. These are maintained separately from this Module 1 video to allow members to refer back to the two additional videos whenever they're needed. As mentioned, the Module 1 pre-work isn't completed until MITs watch the two additional videos. We look forward to seeing you in-game to complete your Fundamental Skills Training Module 1.